And if you didn't, great, that's fine. Some people are much more fluid in their bodies and have had less wear and tear of one sort or another to deal with. Sometimes simple physical disease results in boundaries. You have some kind of physical difficulty and you tense up against it. There's pain, there's disorder. And what? Did you say something?
If you don't face it, if you don't recognize it, it gets to be, something, if you don't recognize it, gets to be as a boundary.
Yeah. Well, even if you face it, it kind of depends on your attitude toward it. That if you like push it away and try and deny it and separate yourself from it, then this can result in tensions and so on. And there's a difference between accepting pain and even welcoming pain. This is an interesting thing you can do. Next time you have some injury or some pain, try welcoming it like an old friend that you haven't seen for some time and actually draw it in. And it's kind of paradoxical, but it actually typically will decrease in intensity. But part of the pain is in fighting against it and pushing away against it. And you stop that, and then often it will diminish in intensity. The message is getting through, so it doesn't have to be as intense. Now, the next step, if you identify some kind of internal boundary, would be to explore, is there some other way that you could do that protection without tensing up your body in some way and sort of separating it in some way? Now, they're the natural divisions of the body, the blood system and the lymph system and the lungs and the heart and all this, and they're all functional divisions. And the kind of divisions that we tend to make with body tension are isolating sort of whole chunks of your body. That's a different kind of division than the natural divisions of the different physiological systems and so on. And given that there can be problems as resulting from these kind of tensions, the overall goal would be to find some way to dissolve or release the block or the boundary that's inside the body. And one way to go about this is to try softening it a little bit and see what kind of images come up, what kind of dangers that might induce you to face. But just as with an external boundary, if you had no boundaries, then someone could come in and harm you. If you didn't have an internal boundary, what would the danger be that you would face? And then see if you can find some other way of dealing with that danger or that threat or that challenge, let's say, that you could do without holding your breath or without isolating some part of your body. Is that, as a general process, does that make sense? There's one gal that's written up in the book who had a little sarcophagus around her heart, like a little stone box, or no, I think it was a metal box or something. I said, well, why don't you lift the lid just a little bit and see what danger would come. As you kind of make yourself a little vulnerable, then figure out, well, what would you be vulnerable to? And so she did that, and we went on from there. Now, a lot of people talk about breakthroughs. If you think about it, a breakthrough presupposes that there's some kind of rigidity there, and you're going to force your way through it. It's inherently unecological. Why not find out alternate behaviors, alternate ways of protecting? And then the hardness can just melt, can just kind of drift away and become softer and softer. So I really think that's a much better way to work. But it does mean really paying attention to what is the positive function of this thing, and how can I take care of that in some other way? As I mentioned, the gal with the walnut shell around her heart, once she got clear, oh, I can have a heart connection with people and not feel obligated. Those are two separate things. And as long as I have coping strategies, like Jim was talking about, well, how can I honor the other person's need at the same time as I honor my need? What kind of things can I say? Well, that's building competence in what to say. It's a fairly simple thing, but important. If you don't know what to say, then you don't know what to say. So if you can develop something like that so that you have a different way of protecting yourself, then you don't have to do it physically in your body, which has potential damaging effects. Now, we could go ahead and actually do some of that. My preference right now is to do a couple of other things that I want to accomplish before we end today. Is that okay with you? Mm-hmm. You have the general strategy? Because it's pretty straightforward. You just kind of weaken the boundary a little bit, open it up a little bit, find out what the danger is, close it back up again as soon as you have some information, then figure out some other way of dealing with that so that you don't have to do something to your body that's artificial. Some people have problems with excitement. They get excitement, then they get too sexy, or they get too wild or something like that, so they shut down their breathing. If you shut down your breathing, you can't get too excited. So that's one way to do it, but there are other ways to do it. Good Lord. You can tone down your excitement in other ways. And then you just have to find some way that works for that person. Okay.
Right here, and then I started melting it away.
Uh-huh.
And I was going, oh, I want to put it back because I want to keep that positive intention there.
Yes. Yeah, you absolutely want to honor the positive intent. Yeah.
And so I was telling my partners, go, I'll go back and work with that.
Okay, great. Wonderful. Yeah. Okay, I'd like you all to close your eyes and put your books down for a minute. I guess I didn't get this window quite shut. And I want you to think of a standard sort of division that most of us have most of the time, and that's between the mind and the body. And just think, you know, just kind of pay attention to your body. And how far does your mind extend? How far does your body extend? Just kind of explore how you have that division in your mind. How far does your mind extend? For many people, it's the same as the brain, essentially. Kind of in the head, and the body is much larger than the mind. But however you divide things, or however you imagine things in your mind, try extending your mind so that your mind goes just as far as your body does. Your mind goes all the way out to your fingertips. And then perhaps imagine reaching out to touch someone special to you, and that when you do, you touch them not just with your body, but with your mind. Because your mind goes all the way out to your fingertips, too. Now, actually, your mind goes out farther than your fingertips. You can picture in your mind the galaxies that are billions of miles away and the stars in the sky. Your mind is actually potentially much larger than your body. In your mind, you can reach out and touch the stars. You can't do that with your body. Now you can do the same kind of thing with your heart. Think about your heart and how you think about your heart in relation to your body. And as you know, the blood vessels, the capillaries from your heart go to every edge of your body. So what if your heart extended as far as your body? From the tips of your fingers to the tips of your toes, top of your head to the bottom of your feet. And then imagine reaching out to a friend or a special friend and doing it with your heart and your mind and your body. And since your heart follows your mind, you can also touch the stars with your heart. You can also extend your heart beyond your body to other people, to other things around you, and even to the stars. Now that's just a little thing I thought I'd offer you. It's kind of similar to some of the things that some mystics have described. And if that's something you feel like you might want to pursue and do more often and become habitual, one more offering. And it's sort of a simple example of how we all tend to build little kind of artificial boundaries. I usually think of my brain and my intelligence is being localized in up here. And then there's the rest of this body that serves it and so on. A life support system. But you don't have to think of it that way. So, another thing to play with. Now the next thing I want to do is a very specific exercise that I think can be quite useful and in a way can tie up some of the things, loose ends and all the things that we've done with the self-concept. I'd like each of you to think, let me just give you some general thing. When we have a boundary around ourselves, it means that we become connected to what's inside the boundary, and we tend to become disconnected to what's outside the boundary, right? So in a situation of safety and intimacy, you can relax your boundaries and you can feel full connection with at least part of the universe. And when you have a boundary up, sort of separates you from something else. Now, I would like you to think of someone, probably someone related to you in some way, someone who's special in some way, and think of two different contexts with that person. One in which you felt very, very connected, no boundaries, and maybe another situation in which you felt disconnected. Now, usually we put up boundaries in times of stress and difficulty. So I'm assuming that disconnection would be some kind of situation of some kind of difficulty. And explore those two alternately and start determining the submodality differences. Maybe jot a few down. What are the differences between your experience of connection and disconnection with the same person? You could do it with different people. The nice thing about doing it with one person is that then everything is the same except the connection or disconnection. And so you get a little cleaner data, but you could also do it with two different people. And take a few minutes to just notice the differences between those two situations.
In connection?
Yeah.
Okay, so they're close?
Yeah.
And give me the contrast.
As opposed to off to the peripheral.
Okay, so centered then?
Yeah, and very clear.
Okay, clear. And centered and periphery?
Yeah.
And clear, and is the other fuzzy or?
To people, yeah, and it's momentary as well for anyone that I'm not.
Okay, well, I want to get contrast between the two.
Okay.
So I'll say fuzzy here, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I need a new pen. Okay, who else? Just kind of raise your hand real quick and yeah.
Larger and smaller.
Okay. Okay, somebody else. Yes.
Soft and hard, soft edges and hard edges.
Soft edge, actually of the image in your memory?
Yes.
Okay.
More colors.
Color here?
Colors and definitely darker.
Darker?
Darker.
And what, less color?
Less color.
Okay.
So as if like the more colors, as if the lights were dimmed.
Dimmed. Okay,
yeah.
Well, that's a little different. So color, less color. Less color? Or
yeah, less, definitely less color.
Okay.
And lighter and dimmer.
Okay, good. So dimmer, lighter. Okay.
Panoramic and small frame.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Small. Okay, now these are all visual so far.
I have a kinesthetic.
Phil,
okay.
I have kinesthetic
mm-hmm.
also.
Okay, go ahead, Katie.
Warmer, colder.
Warmer,
yeah.
Colder.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and
I have intense.
Tightness?
Yeah, intense. It's
intense.
Intense.
Intense here?
Intense.
Yes.
Okay, and?
It's no feeling anymore.
No feeling. Okay, so here's strong feeling.
Strong and, yeah.
Okay. And here it's, what word did you use? It's no feeling.
No feeling.
No
feeling.
Okay. How about auditory?
Soft tone.
Soft tones? Okay, so that you could put that with this here. That'll make it easier for me to write.
Soft tone, it can be incomplete sentences as well when they're connected.
Oh, this can be incomplete? Okay. And these are complete?
Yeah.
Okay. Tell me a little bit about that. Incomplete sentence, it means you just say a word or two
no,
and you're understood?
It's like, I'm thinking of the dance of rapport, where you say, and you're both connecting, so you know.
You don't need
you don't
very
need
few
to
words.
Yes.
That's
mm-hmm.
good, yeah. Okay. Now, what was it? Oh,
soft tones.
Soft tones, what's the opposite of soft tones? Who was
I guess,
it?
Yeah, it was me. Soft tones, I guess it would be.
Hard, staccato?
Sharp.
Okay. Okay, a couple more?
Deep and shrill.
Deep and
deeper,
shrill.
Deeper, yeah, deeper, closer is more deeper.
So this is auditory?
Auditory, yeah.
Okay. Okay, deep. And shrillness and sharpness presupposed tension, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's when your voice becomes sharp
or
high, is when there's more tension. Even if it's just visual breathing versus kinesthetic breathing, there's a little more tension in the body. So if it goes shrill and sharp, that would be more tension, right?
It's
so it's relaxation. Okay, I think that's enough. Now, some of you have been through this before, so you know where you're going with this. Especially those of you who haven't experienced the seminar before, which of these states is more resourceful? duh, right? Duh. This one's clearly more resourceful, right? Now, isn't it interesting that you're going into a situation of disconnection, which I defined as being some kind of stress, some kind of challenge, and it's as if you throw away all your resources. This is like an explorer is going to go down to the Arctic or something like that. He throws away his tent, he throws away his cook pots, throws away his food, and then he heads out across the ice. We all do it. But does it make sense? It really doesn't. Because this is impoverished. This has much less information. It has much less detail, much less richness of internal world. And we're going to try and solve a problem in this state. It's nuts. I mean, our bodies do some stupid things, too. You know, there's this thing called shock, where certain set of things happen, and the body goes berserk and destroys itself. So there's certain things that are, quote, natural, but not necessarily healthy, even in physiology. Now, here's my proposal. You all know about mapping across with submodalities, right? Start with this content of disconnection. I've defined it as being the same person, but it's a different context, different situation. Think about that situation of disconnection and go into it with these submodalities, and then start mapping across tension to relaxation, periphery to center, or whatever you do, because here this is a group thing, and not you didn't. Each of you didn't do all of these things. But whatever is on your list, map across into this more resourceful state of connection.